Welcome to the Sport of Politics with Joel Robidoux on 103.7 The Game. Online at 103.7thegame.com. We discuss the local issues affecting you and the Acadiana area with Lafayette City Parish Mayor President Joel Robidoux. From time to time, we'll have special guests and always make time to take your calls. Now, time for the Sport of Politics with Joel Robidoux. Here's your host, Dave Schultz.
Hi, welcome to the Sport of Politics with Lafayette City Parish Mayor President Joel Robidoux on Acadiana Sports Station 103.7 The Game and 103.7thegame.com. We will also be on KDCG on Friday at 7 a.m. Lots to do today as the special session came down to the end yesterday, and I think we had a two-minute warning. We had a couple of full and 30-second timeouts. Yeah, there may have been a couple of technicals.
All of the above.
Yeah. Overall, how do you think it went? It seemed to go better for this budget, and now we have an issue for next year's budget, but one at a time, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, they did solve the short-term problem that exists, which was, you know, there was about a $950 million shortfall for the year that ends this June 30th. So there was either going to be, you know, almost $1 billion in cuts here in the last 4 months of the year, which would have effectively shut down some universities,
right,
and hospitals and those kinds of things. And so I think the focus of the special session was, what can we do to make sure that doesn't happen? And, you know, all the papers are reporting and the news media outlets are reporting that they pretty much did that, solved the $950 million with the exception of maybe $30 million. But truth be told, you know, they don't know exactly. They may have actually generated over $950. They may have come in a little bit worse than $30 million short. So I think, though, overall, if you're looking at it from, did they fix the immediate problem, they did. They didn't do it in a pretty way.
No.
But it's not a pretty process. Right. And you know, the problem is that anytime negotiations are part of the process, that people are willing to come to a consensus at the end more likely than they are 2 weeks out. That's just, I think, human nature. And so that's why it kind of all came flooding in right there at the very end.
Well, that happens whether you're doing any kind of negotiations. When there's a deadline, mm-hmm,
you push up to the deadline.
Wait until the deadline, whether it's sports, business, or
government. Politics, yeah.
Or government. Mm-hmm. One of the things, this was so fast and furious yesterday, and I'm following it on Twitter, which was a great way to do it.
Yeah.
Outside of being right there. They were making, this was happening so fast, they were putting amendments to the wrong bill.
Yeah, that did happen.
Unintentionally, obviously, but that's what happened. They didn't know, mm-hmm, what bill they were on, so they were adding amendments, and then they had to vote to take the amendments off.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, I think on the Senate side, they had actually put the amendments on the wrong bill and had to bring it back up, take the amendments off of that bill. And but, you know, that's what happens when you're faced with a very limited time frame. And you know, it's easy for folks to say, well, they could have got all this done 2 or 3 weeks ago. But the truth is, that means either the Democrats would have had to accept more cuts 2 weeks ago,
right,
or the Republicans would have had to accept more tax revenue 2 weeks ago. And they both fought till the bitter end as best they could, and then finally, you know, made the decisions that they ultimately made. So, like you said, that's just whether it's a sports contract or whatever it is. If there's negotiations involved, typically comes to the bitter end. That's why they call it making sausage, because it's not
right.
Pretty.
And you don't want to see it. No one ever wants to see it. We hope to have the governor on, and actually Senator Vitter on next week, if not in the upcoming weeks after that. And one of the questions we'd ask Senator Vitter is, you know, be careful what you wish for, because, well, you know, I bet you've been sleeping a lot better the last 4 months than Governor Edwards is. You don't have to deal with this mess that he's been dealing with immediately when he gets into office.
Yeah, I think probably, with the exception maybe of a few legislators, everyone has slept better than the governor. I mean, he certainly had a difficult task ahead of him. And it's not going away. I mean,
no.
they have the problem now of they're trying to craft what will be the 2016-17 bill, basically July of 16 through June of 17, which is the budget year for the state. They got to start figuring that out, and they're about another, $1 billion short for that one.
Is there a little bit more time to figure that out compared to the 3 weeks that they just had? Is there a little bit more spacing? Even though, like we've been mentioning, it probably won't get done until the last minute, but at least they may have a little bit more time to discuss it.
They will certainly have more time to discuss it, but they won't be able to introduce legislation to fix it because it's a general session. It's
right.
Not a fiscal session, which is when you can address tax and tax credits and all of those fiscal issues. That's not part of this upcoming session. This is a general session where you can, change the age to get your driver's license,
right?
Where you can do all the general stuff that's out there, but you can't tackle fiscal issues. So the fiscal solution will not happen during that. So they'll probably have to come in for another special session. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. All right. And when do you think that would be?
Well, they have two choices. They can either do a special session and run it during the regular session.
Right.
Like run the special session in the mornings and the regular session in the afternoon, evenings.
Right.
Or they can, as soon as the general session's finished in June, they can then wait the mandatory week or two and then start another special session to address the budget crisis at that point.
And if you had your druthers, if you were doing this, as you probably have done in the past.
Yeah, I would probably do it at the same time.
Right.
I think a lot of the focus during the session is going to be what we should have, could have, would have done during the special. And so for that reason, I'd say let's go ahead and just keep this ball rolling. But I could certainly understand someone that made the point to say, well, no, let's use these next, 10 or 12 weeks of the regular session to have meeting and to put a plan together. So when we go back into special session, we know what we're going to do. And so that gives us that amount of time to kind of go into it. But again, the planning is really a different word for negotiations. And
right.
so
right.
if it's all going to wait till the bitter end anyway, then 10 weeks of planning doesn't really get you a whole lot.
Right. And then if it's after the session in June, then they're up against it time-wise again.
That's right.
Before July hits.
That's
so,
correct.
Even though the special session, I presume the length would be the same amount of time, regardless of when it is.
Yeah. And the difficulty in waiting after, or one of the difficulties, is that during the general session, you have to craft a budget. So you have to craft a budget with, $800 million more in cuts. And because you don't have the revenue, and we're required by the Constitution in the state of Louisiana to do a balanced budget. So you can't say, well, we're gonna fix it in this special session coming up. You don't have that option. So what you would actually do is you would pass a budget with all the cuts, go into the special session, figure out what cuts are gonna stay, what additional revenue you might be able to get, and then do a modified budget then. Which may be a good strategy, do $800 million in cuts and see how much more willing people are to vote for revenue then, if you
right,
do that.
Right.
So I don't know what their strategy is going to be. I'm just glad I'm not there.
Right, right. And then one would have to think that real life would come into this. Lack of a better term, summer vacation, right? People have families and kids and July's going to be the month they can, no sports are going on and, outside of summer, maybe baseball travel, but, before football starts up again, late July or early August. And so I'm guessing that legislatures don't want to be spending July or, late June and early July in a special session.
I agree. They don't want to be, obviously.
Right.
But I will say this in the legislators' defense. For the most part, this is a big enough crisis that they may have to have some tough conversations with the kids and the spouses.
Right.
And to say, look, it may not be till August before we get to go do something. This is not a summer to plan on having a vacation.
Right. That could be the case. All right. We'll take your phone call, 706-01. 1-1, 706-0111. Let's take a break. Want to thank the Mayor Joel Robideau for being here, Mayor President Joel Robideau. Sport of Politics now powered by Charlie G's. We got a sponsor for the show.
Oh, that's great.
We're very happy to have them aboard. We'll get the details.
Ducking on Dewey Gumbo, by the way.
Right, there you go.
From Charlie G's.
There you go. We will we'll go over the details, because what I saw was all four pennies are clean. We'll see if that's the case moving forward, as there was a sales tax increase, I think, at least for the for this immediate budget. We'll be back with more on the Sport of Politics on Acadiana Sports Station, 103.7 The Game and 103.7thegame.com and mobile app powered by McDonald's. We got the crawfish festival in Acadiana.
We got the Boudin festival in Acadiana. Now, back to Sport of Politics on 103.7 The Game and 103.7thegame.com with Lafayette City Parish Mayor President Joel Robideau. Here's your host, Dave Schultz.
Hi, welcome back to the Sport of Politics with Mayor President Joel Robideau. I'm Dave Schultz. We'll be happy to take your phone calls, talking Louisiana budget. Boy, it's a real shame we started the show this year, because there's nothing going on in politics these days.
Yeah, it's quiet. It's been real quiet.
Really boring. We'll take your call, 706-0111, 706-0111. All right, so I'm reading NOLA.com. And so let's, before we talk about what they did, let's talk about how we got here. And this is from NOLA.com. Apparently, there was the Stelly plan, and that was tossed out. Is that what I'm, is that correct?
That is correct.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Can you tell everybody what the Stelly plan is? I'm sure most people know, but I don't.
Right.
So tell us what the Stelly plan was. It was in place, and then it was taken away.
Yeah, if you'd been here and filed tax returns, you'd have known what the Stelly plan was.
Right,
because that's why it became such a big deal and why so many legislators wanted to take it away. The legislature and the governor had passed what became known as the Stelly plan, under name for Vic Stelly.
Governor Blanco.
It was before Governor Blanco.
Oh, okay, even before Governor Blanco.
Yeah,
okay,
that's right. And so that Stelly plan, what it basically did was, it had two pieces. It pretty simple. It said we're no longer going to tax, you know, food and certain prescription drugs, and so we're going to exempt all of that from sales tax. You're no longer going to have to pay that when you go to the grocery store. In exchange for that, we're going to change the income tax brackets. So that, you know, whether you pay 2%, 4%, 6%, you know, depending on your range of income, you bumped into the next bracket and the next bracket. They changed those ranges and added another bracket at 8%. And so they raised income taxes, right, and gave away, and they said it's revenue neutral. It had to go because it was an income tax increase. They made it a constitutional amendment, so the voters had to vote on it. So it went on a ballot that the entire state of Louisiana voted on. And when they voted on it, you know, there was a good media push. I shouldn't say media, but, you know, public service announcements and all about how this is revenue neutral and it's a good exchange and it's something that we should do, and it passed.
Was it revenue neutral? That's what they were saying, but was it?
Well,
Meaning.
Okay. So to define revenue neutral, right, what they're saying is at this moment in time, it's revenue neutral. But ultimately, you know, income taxes, as your economy grows, income taxes are going to outpace sales taxes.
Right.
And so they knew, you know, they didn't know. The anticipation was that we'll ultimately get more money out of this than if we don't do anything. And so it passed, and so... Sure enough, I mean, it didn't take long. They were collecting about $300 million more in revenue,
right,
the state was, because of the passage of the Stelly. Well, what happened, though, was for middle-class taxpayers, they're saying, hey, nothing's changed. My wife and I have been school teachers for 20-something years. I've made the same amount of money the last 2 years, but my taxes went up $800.
Right.
What's the deal? Well, the Stelly plan is why it went up $800. And the political reality is that I could talk till I was blue in the face and explain, well, but you saved probably $740 in sales taxes if you add up all your grocery receipts and went back and looked at those. But, you know, it was $5 here and it was $8 here. And, you know, over the course of the year, though, you really didn't get popped by $800. You might have paid $100 or $80 more, something like that. That fell on deaf ears across the state. The voters felt like they had been misled to say that it was revenue neutral, because the state got $300 million in revenue more and it looked like it was going to continue to go. A lot of legislators at that time, myself included, ran on a platform of repealing STELE. Under Kathleen Blanco, we repealed a portion of it. And then under Jindal, we repealed another chunk of it, but we never touched the side where you got the sales tax exemption on food and utilities and all of that. So we took away the revenue raising piece of it and we kept the expenditure piece of it. You know, hindsight's 2020. If you wanted to get rid of STELE, what we should have done was just gotten rid of STELE.
Right.
Which means both pieces. And then it would have ended up costing the state, you know, maybe $300 million, right? That they had only received one or two years. But what we did is we kept the exemption piece and we got rid of the revenue piece. So it ended up costing us probably closer to $600 million when we got rid of it. Because in effect, what we did is the STELE plan was now, hey, you no longer have to pay sales tax on your groceries and utilities and some other things. And there was no revenue side of it. There was no trade-off. And so that was the start of the problem. But it didn't seem like a problem because we were in the middle of the Katrina rebuild.
Right,
having an energy boom. So there was all kinds of money flowing into the state coffers, which is why the discussion even came up. It's kind of like, wait, we've got a $1 billion surplus coming up.
Right.
We really need to keep the STELE thing in place, which is $300 million on top of that.
Right.
And so then that's when it was taken away. Of course, the energy boom has since faded, and the Katrina boom rebuilding Katrina and Rita has since faded. And so we're kind of left back to where we were really almost 8 to 12 years ago and saying, all right, so this is where we are. Well, insurance is more expensive, and so you have all these government expenditures that have gone up, but you're stuck with the same revenue that you had way back, you know, a decade or more ago.
So no one suggested to bring it back? Was that an option in this special session?
I don't think so. No. I don't think anybody talked about the bringing back the STELE. There was bills to redo the income tax structure and change the rates and do all of that. So it would have been a new legislator's name on it.
Right.
It wouldn't have been STELE.
Right. Well, this is what I'm reading. In 07 and 08 fiscal cycle, Louisiana's spending plan of $28.6 billion. The year before Hurricane Katrina, total state spending was $16.5 billion. Goodness gracious. That's almost 80% increase.
Right.
Almost 100%, you know, if you think about it, almost. All right. The legislature expected this year's state budget to be $24.5 billion or $4 billion less than it was 07, 08. And they're trying to make up, you know, a billion here, and a billionaire starts to add up fast. And, well, they almost made up a billion in a special session. Now they have to apparently find almost a billion for next year's session, but now they need to find almost another $800 million.
Right. And let me just say to make sure that you and the listeners understand, the 20-something billion that they're talking about versus the 16,
right?
That's whatever, $10 billion greater.
Right.
I would probably speculate, and I don't have the numbers, but in my head, I mean, I was there during that time.
Sure.
I would say probably $9.4 billion or so of that is federal money. So,
right, yes.
So
correct.
So we have to spend it on No Child Left Behind. We have to spend it on what the feds say to spend it on.
Sidewalks.
when we talk about what the legislature and the governor are doing, that's the state. That is somewhere in the neighborhood of an $8 or $9 billion portion of that total. And that has fluctuated. The highest it got was around $10 billion, the state income tax, sales tax, and that. Not the federal money.
Right.
And it went down to as low as probably $6.7 billion during the Jindal administration. So it's the gap of the state money, not the federal money. Because the feds tell us, here's your money and here's what you have to do with it.
Right.
But the legislature appropriates the state revenue. And so during that time period, I think under Blanco, we had gotten up to close to $10 billion on one of those years, certainly high nines or low tens. And then that started to subside and went down to low nines and then high eights and then mid eights and then low eights and then high sevens and $7 billion. So that was always that was the 8 years during the general administration, was trying to manage the reduction in the state revenue side. And so it's misleading to look at the total 26 and say, oh, that's what the legislature and the governor have to deal with.
Right.
Because it's just not the case. Because I agree. It's
plenty of plenty of federal aid was in coming.
But we were not necessarily able to say exactly how we wanted that to be spent.
Right, right. All right, let's go out to the ropesopanddope.com hotline and talk to Mary Ann. Wants to talk to Mayor President Joel Robideau. Thanks for calling, Mary Ann.
Good morning, Mr. Mayor. Good morning, David Schultz. I told the mayor in the meeting the other day I'd be calling him. Thank you, Mr. Mayor, for giving me that time in your office along with the other people that you had present and that I had asked would be present. And I wanted to call for one reason, not only just to thank you, but to say that I was negligent, Mr. Mayor, President, on something, and I want to mention it publicly and over the air. I wanted you to know that when I got to my home and reflected over that meeting, I remembered that I was supposed to ask you, and I was supposed to ask if I could lead off with a little prayer to the Holy Spirit when you all entered that room. And I failed to do that. And I don't know why, that just bothered me. And I said, I want to just come over the air, not only to thank you, but to just say that I ask the Lord's forgiveness for that, because he sure helped me to formulate my thoughts well for that meeting. And I wanted to just acknowledge the fact that I maybe slipped up by not having a little prayer before. Well, also, I wanted to thank Mr. David Schultz, because I told the mayor, Mr. Schultz, you have a delightful personality. I like to hear you laugh, and I like to just hear you all going back and forth. And I want to hear some more, a little bit about Lafayette issues. But right now, the mayor's like I am, we're concerned about our state budget. But God bless you all. And again, Mr. Mayor, thank you for the time. I will be following up with both you and Mr. Duyon in the next few weeks. To just kind of see, you know, where you all are, because you said you had to think about the direction you wanted to go for our paratransit service. But God bless you in the work you do. And thank you, Mr. Schultz. Have a good day.
Well, thank you, Mary Ann. I appreciate it. And, you know, we had a great meeting, and certainly I respect everything that, you know, that you said at the meeting and all the preparation that you did. And you're very kind to call and say all those kind things. And you did tell me how much you enjoyed Dave Schultz, which was a surprise to me. But, hey, so at least he knows he has one fan.
Right, that's one. That's one. Do you want to share what the meeting was about? Or is that
Well, no. Okay. Ms. Vaquero is probably one of the leading community activists as it relates to the paratransit services that we have here in Lafayette for the blind, the disabled, anybody that needs transportation. Mm-hmm. And so that contract's coming up for renewal. So she wanted to make sure that we considered certain things to, you know, improve the service. And then, you know, I'm all ears. I mean, she's been an incredible advocate for the folks that need those services. And so I appreciate the effort that she puts into that.
How do you get Uber involved in that? Because I understand taking a couple of Uber rides that I do, they do get, you know, senior citizens just going to the grocery, right? And it's 2 minute, 5 minute ride, whatever it is, very easy. And then they get them to come when they, you know, pick them back up, maybe another driver, but so be it. And they also mentioned they had some people who are blind and just need to go from place to place. Is there any way to do a public-private transaction there?
There very well could be. You know, it probably would all come down to the pricing of it and right, what kind of, you know, negotiation.
Sure, right.
It'd be a last minute to go down to the wire. But yeah, I mean, any service that we can provide and we can improve upon, I'm all ears. Mm-hmm. And if that includes factoring Uber into it, then great. But I will say that, you know, there's some, you know, some predictability that's needed, some scheduling that's needed
right.
there. So the Uber model doesn't work as well. You know, it doesn't
not
seem
perfect,
because it's more spontaneous.
Right, right.
Hey, I want to go. But certainly, certainly worth considering, because
yeah.
Uber is changing the right. landscape as it relates to public transportation, you know, significantly.
Absolutely. All right, let's take a time out. We'll take more of your phone calls. We'll actually hear what the legislature did. We haven't gotten to that. We'll talk some local issues as well. It is a Sport of Politics powered by Charlie G's, Lafayette City Parish Mayor President Joel Robidoux on Acadiana Sports Station 103.7 The Game and 103.7thegame.com and mobile app powered by McDonald's.
Back to Sport and Politics on 103.7 The Game and 103.7thegame.com.
All right, Dave Schultz, along with the Mayor President Joel Robidoux from Lafayette City Parish. We'll be happy to take any more phone calls. We appreciate your phone call, Marianne. Thank you so much. 706-0111, 706-0111. All right, so we've sort of danced around it. We haven't gotten to what the legislature did last night. Apparently, they did increase the sales tax by
yep.
a penny, but maybe more importantly, or I don't know about more importantly, but what they did was, did they clean all four pennies? Did they take all the exemptions away for this, for the 2015-2016 budget compared to moving forward? Is that correct?
That's pretty close to correct, yeah.
And they, wow, one for
yeah,
me.
Yeah, that's it. They, yeah, they raised the sales taxes a penny. So the state, you know, for most of this area, it's an 8% sales tax. We have a couple of TIF districts in a couple of different municipalities and areas that may have an additional tax, sales tax that was put on by the voters for, you know, maybe a police or to pay for infrastructure like at the Louisiana Avenue. But the state's portion has always been 4 cents, 4% of whatever your purchase was, and they added another penny to that. So so that's part of it. And they made that penny what's called a clean penny.
Right.
But that one's kind of a clean penny. It's not
kind
totally.
Of,
yeah.
Right.
It's the majority of the exemptions and exclusions related to that penny don't apply. But for that one, I think, there were so many amendments that were flying around
right.
yesterday. You know, there's still some on that first penny. What they then did was they said, okay, well, let's look at the four pennies that we've been collecting. And there was a bill that was passed to clean those four pennies entirely. And so they will be cleaned entirely for the rest of this fiscal year, which ends June 30th. So basically whatever that is, 4 months or so.
Right.
And then starting July 1st, they will put the exemptions back on two of those pennies. So then you'll only have the two clean pennies at that point, plus the brand new one clean penny going forward.
So if we got five pennies now?
We have five pennies.
We got five pennies.
Five
All
pennies,
right.
And the question is, are they clean or are they not clean?
Right.
But they'll all be clean for the next 4 months.
Including, I think the one thing we did, the one exemption we did hear was large purchases, machinery
Well,
purchases.
Manufacturing machinery and equipment.
Yeah.
But that was why I kind of stuttered when I
we
first started, because there was so many amendments flying around.
Right.
I think manufacturing machinery and equipment may still be exempted from one of those pennies.
Right.
But I think when we clean the other four, I think that exemption was taken away. So if somebody buys a big piece of manufacturing equipment, I think they're going to pay the pennies for the next 4 months, which business community would argue, well, then guess what?
We're waiting until July 1st.
We're
going to
wait until July 1st.
Right.
You know.
Right. All right. What about, I think cigarettes went up.
Cigarettes, alcohol.
Significant tax?
Pretty significant. Yeah, the cigarettes went up another 30-something cents. So I think it's at $1.08. Is the tax now, when this time last year, it was 32 cents on a tax on a pack of cigarettes. We bumped it up to 68 cents, and then they've just now bumped it up to $1.08.
So cigarette tax has gone up 300%.
300% since this time last year.
In a year, okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Hopefully that does crimp someone's pocket and maybe prevents them from smoking. That's A.
Right.
And that's one of those odd catch-22s, right, because you raise the tax because you need the revenue, but at the same time you're hoping that you've raised it enough that it, you know, at least for underage smokers, that it somehow curbs the people's smoking habits, and that there's a reduction in that, so it would lower the tax. So you kind of want both of those things to happen, which, you know, kind of conflict with each other.
Well, if there's a reduction, hopefully that would reduce health costs.
That's right.
Eventually, and then it balances it out, or even we come out ahead.
Probably would come out ahead, but that's a very long term.
It is long term, but okay.
It's still good.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then alcohol, how much did that go up?
I don't have any idea. Okay. But because they're all different. You know, it's a percentage. Wine is different than beer, is different than hard liquor. And so I'm not sure how they adjusted all of those.
So I'm probably paying more tax
on my
bourbon, because I'm being uppity about that, compared to, say, a light beer.
Probably so. That's right. Yes.
All right. So do you know what else? I think the sales tax one, and the sin taxes, if you will, on cigarettes and alcohol.
Yeah.
What else was passed that you know of? And do you know anything that was not passed at the last minute?
Yeah. I think there was also a rental car tax that was used to be on the books, was taken off, and it's back on. I'm not sure that, you know, affects a whole lot of Louisiana residents, but, you know, for folks that are coming into town, there'll be a tax on the rental cars. And then the one that didn't pass, but it looked like it was, and then the paper actually published that it was passed, and there was an article this morning, but it just goes to show you can't always believe what you read, because it's not an indictment of the media in any way, because it was so crazy for the last hour or two of the session that I could see how someone would have made that mistake.
Sure.
But there was a tax that was going to be placed on all stadiums, domes, and if it wasn't an athletic event. So basically Cajun Dome, Tiger Stadium, you know, any event that you had there that wasn't sports, then you was going to be, whatever purchases happened were going to be subject to tax. Mostly concerts. If you have some festivals, if you have a big convention, any of that stuff, it is now subject to the tax according to the Senate Bill 22. And then there was a back and forth because they were trying to dedicate some of the money instead of it going to local government. They're saying, well, why don't we give it back to the you know, higher ed institution that owns the stadium,
right?
You know, because that's who we're cutting and all that. So there was a bunch of amendments, and it looked like finally they worked out an agreement. It ended up passing the House, I think, with less than a minute to go, and it never got called up on the Senate side. So in effect,
how could it?
Right. Even though they had an agreement, it didn't pass. So there won't be that tax was one, and that wasn't a huge one. I mean,
that sounds like the Tiger Stadium Superdome tax.
That's kind of
right. There's plenty of events in the Cajun Dome, but. Yeah. Size wise,
right? CenturyLink and up in the Shreveport-Bossier area.
Right.
You know, so there was a few that, you know, they were going to that, and but nonetheless, that was one that was assumed to have passed, reported to have passed, but actually didn't.
So Smoothie King, I guess. So you're telling me my Def Leppard and Styx tickets are not going to be taxed any additional money?
Well, unless they have another special session, since that was one of the ones that had made it to the finish line, it may become the Phoenix.
All right. So make sure that the special session starts after the show, which is May 4th.
It will. Unless they're doing it concurrently. If they run it during the regular session and the special together, but the majority of the money that was raised is coming from the one penny sales tax and the new clean 4 cents pennies that are out there. That's 90-something% of the money that was raised. And then, you know, they probably had close to 200 million more in cuts. You know, we had probably made 400 or 500 million in cuts last year. So, you know, those cuts are all real, and they're, if you look at them cumulatively, there's probably been close to $1 billion in cuts over the last 4 years, you know.
All right, we will be back. We'll, again, happy to take your phone call, 706-01-11, 706-01-11. We'll see how all of this affects Acadiana. Any ribbon cutting today at, Ambassador Town Center? I mean, it's...
No, but a few of those next week, I think.
Okay.
And they may have gotten rained out if they were this week anyway. So.
Oh, all right. Well, so, Nordstrom had a big sale. I'm surprised you're not there, the classy dresser that you are.
Yeah, well, anybody that watches TV on Friday morning on KDCG knows better than that.
We'll be back after this with more Sport of Politics with Mayor President Joel Robineau, powered by Charlie G's on Acadiana Sports Station 103.7 The Game.
Now, back to Sport of Politics on 103.7 The Game and 103.7thegame.com with Lafayette City Parish Mayor President Joel Robideau. Here's your host, Dave Schultz.
All right, back with Mayor President Joel Robideau of Lafayette City Parish on Sport of Politics, now powered by Charlie G's on Acadiana Sports Station 103.7 The Game. Of course, we'll be on KDCG Friday at 7, so you can tune in to see, again, the spiffy dressing. We both got little nice sport jackets on today.
Yeah.
You come all dressed up, I got to step up my game.
I gotcha. I should have worn a tie.
Yeah, well, we may not want to do that. Okay, so we're talking about all these tax increases. How does that affect the local government here in Acadiana?
You know, the sales taxes, you know, I don't think are going to have much of an effect on people's shopping habits. That's not to say that it won't have any, but I don't think it's going to be front and center in people's mind. I mean, most of us individually don't get exemptions anyway. I mean, we pay the full tax. So the clean penny part of it, what do we care, right? That's more business related. But as you're talking about the extra one penny, you know, how much of a behavioral change will that cause? You know, I don't think it'll be that big a deal. Where it does affect local government, though, is where, you know, the school board was talking about maybe going to the voters from some additional tax revenue to fix what is just a incredibly overdue problem. You know, Butler buildings everywhere, and so they need to build some more schools and do some things. Well, you know, now you're putting it on top of the state having just put a new penny, so they've pulled back on that, factoring that in with the economy. So it has an effect in that the government locally, you know, our hands are tied. If there was anything we wanted to do as it related to you know, like we wouldn't have been able to go to the voters with an airport tax right now.
Right.
We did it, got it, it worked, and we socked that money away, and they're going to be using it soon to get the airport done. But you wouldn't be able to do that. If right now we were in the middle of it, we'd probably have to pull back, you know, and say, yeah, it's probably not a good time to go to the voters and put an additional tax of our own on top of what the state's already done.
How is that airport, enlargement, I guess.
Yes.
Increased size of the airport. How is that going to affect the economy here in Lafayette? Because I'll tell you, I have driven plenty of times. I'm sure I'm not the only one. Driven to Houston or mostly to New Orleans. Mm-hmm. And it's not the drive there, even though I cut it close with the planes that I'm trying to catch. But it's the two-hour drive back.
Yes.
And when you can land in Lafayette, even me, when it's 9 or 10 p.m. and I don't have to do that two-hour ride back, I can stay home with the family longer or my friends or whatever the case is.
Mm-hmm.
So how is that going to affect the economy here?
Oh, I think it'll serve two significant purposes. One is going to expand the number of terminals. And so obviously the idea is to be able to ultimately get another airline here.
Right.
Because we'll have an additional gate. And then it's also to start to build all the revenue sources that an airport can generate, which, you know, our existing terminal was very limited in what you can do there. And then secondly, and you know, it's an intangible, but you want people's impression when they're coming to Lafayette.
Sure.
You want it to be one of, you know, that shows how dynamic and successful a community you are. And so it'll certainly provide that for us too.
So when's that supposed to start?
They're starting now, but you know, it's anytime it's that large of an infrastructure project, I mean, it's a lot of planning, it's a lot of architects. And so there's a lot of stuff going on that no one sees, you know, no one really sees anything until they start, you know, breaking down walls and shoveling some dirt around. And so, we're in the process of getting all the planning and the engineering and architectural stuff done that right now. So it's already happening.
All right. So now what about you got qualifications for police chief, new qualifications for the police chief?
Yeah. Well, you know, when Chief Kraft decided that he was going to hang it up after, I think, close to 40 years, 39 or 40 years, you know, it put the burden on me to find a replacement. I named an interim chief, Reginald Thomas, who's done a great job so far. And so then I needed to start the process of finding a permanent replacement, which, you know, includes advertising for the position, and it's a civil service position. So you have to go through civil service, and so they have to post what the qualifications are for so many days, and then people can apply, then take the test, and then rank them according to their scores on the test, and then have a committee to look over all the resumes and the individuals. So the first step in the process, it was look at the qualifications and get the Civil Service Board to post. Well, when I looked at the qualifications, we were so out of line with the rest of every community in this state and actually the country, you know, whereas so I did a spreadsheet because I'm a nerd and compared, right. And compared how we do it. But the bottom line is, ours was written to say if you have a bachelor's degree and 10 years of experience, no supervisory experience, just 10 years, and a bachelor's degree, or if you'd been part of the service, police department since October of 1979, then you qualify to apply. Well, we don't have anybody that's been there before 1979.
Right.
It was written specifically to allow certain people to qualify.
Right.
But now we don't have any, and at some point you'd have to be 100 years old to qualify. So the only qualification we have is, for Lafayette, bachelor's degree, 10 years experience. So, I mean, I could have in some areas, a patrolman working in another smaller community here in Lafayette that has a degree that could apply for the chief of police. But most of my majors can't apply because they don't fit that criteria.
Right.
Well over half of my captains, I'm going in rank order. The top is major, then captains. Over half cannot apply under that criteria. Then you drop down to lieutenants, and maybe half or a little over half can apply. So, you know, of the top three ranked tiers, most of them can't apply for the chief of police. But a motorcycle policeman from some other community in the state that has a bachelor's degree can apply, you know. So my fear was I could get, you know, a bunch of 30-something-year-olds applying to be the chief of police, and none of my top-ranking officials, not none, a vast majority of my top rank can't even apply for the job. So I said, we need to get in line with what other folks are doing. So I went to the Civil Service Board, and I know we need to take a break. So how about I explain where we are when we come back?
Okay. All right. We'll take one break and then come back and wrap up the show and find out where we are with the qualifications for the new police chief. That all seems to make sense. We'll be back with more on Sport of Politics, powered by Charlie G's, with Mayor President Joel Robidoux after this on Acadiana Sports Station 103.7 The Game.
Back to Sport of Politics on 103.7 The Game and 103.7thegame.com.
All right, Dave Schultz, Mayor Joel Robidoux on the Sport of Politics, powered by Charlie G's. All right, let's wrap things up, talk about the new qualifications for the police chief. We just have a few minutes.
Yeah, sure. So, you know, real quickly, so I looked at everybody else's around the state of likes, size communities, and then kind of put, you know, our own little Lafayette mentality to it. And so what we're basically saying is, if you do have a degree, you have to have the 15 years with a couple of years as supervisory experience. If you don't have a degree but you have an associate's degree, we actually are one of the few forces, certainly in the state but also in the country, that require our majors and captains to have certain college hours. So if you're a captain and you're eligible to be promoted to be major because of your tenure, but you don't have enough college hours, then you can't. So you would stay a captain. So I incorporated that in ours. And so if you have an associate degree or the educational hours that a major is required to have, then you can be the chief of police, but you have to have some additional experience. And so instead of 15 years, like for a bachelor's degree, you have to have 20 years and 5 years of supervisory experience. And then if you have the educational requirements that we place on our captains, college educational requirements. If you have, and I think it's around 40 hours, then you can apply for the job. If you have 25 years and some years of supervisor experience. So I think it's a good combination. I think it puts us in a better position than every other community in the state, as opposed to the opposite now, which is where we have the worst qualifications out there. This, I think, allows to where we're going to have a great big pool of extremely talented folks, and it's going to make a difficult decision for me, but I'm willing to make that because I think it'll attract a significant pool of talented applicants. So looking forward to it.
And this process is going to be about a year with it already having
started? It'll happen towards the end of the summer or the fall. But the first step is I need for folks, if they think it's a good idea, to publicly weigh in, because there's a 30-day period where the Civil Service Board is going to listen to. If the public thinks it's a good idea, I don't see how anybody could say it's not a good idea compared to what we have. So we got to wait the 30 days for public input. And then we'll go before the Civil Service Board, and they'll give it their blessing or not. And whatever they decide, it'll be posted, and that'll be the qualifications that it takes to apply for the chief of police position in Lafayette.
And then how long do you take applicants for?
So then you take applicants. You can keep it open for 30 days, 45 okay. days. Just kind of depends on you. And then once that happens, they'll then schedule a test once the application period closes, and all those individuals will go and take the test. And then after those results are in is when you can start kind of ranking them and interviewing them and deciding who you want to interview, and then go from there and make the decision.
All right. Good show. All right. Next week could be a little boring. Nothing going on. Well, general session's starting.
There'll be something going on.
Absolutely.
I can assure you there'll be something going
It'll
on.
It'll be huge. Huge. All right. Want to thank Mayor President Joel Robideau for joining us as well on the Sport of Politics. We'll be on KDCG 7 a.m. on Friday if you missed part of the show here on the radio. I want to thank Dylan, Allen, and Moses for doing a bang-up job. The effort is always appreciated. Thank you for tuning in. Please tune in next week for another edition of the Sport of Politics on Acadiana Sports Station, 103.7 The Game and 103.7thegame.com.